I'm going to be honest. It was a little tepid. How's everyone feeling? Come on. I heard Santa Fe was where crazy people live. I want to see how crazy you all are. Let me hear a primal scream. That's exactly what I wanted. This panel, I will venture to say, may be one of the finest in this very fine two-day event, and it is about intelligent systems. It's no accident that one of the most intelligent people in Santa Fe, David Krakauer, is both involved in it and sort of moderating it, although we hope it's going to be more of a free-for-all. David, I think, requires no introduction, and therefore I won't give him one. Vanessa,
good, man.
Yeah. Vanessa is many things, but has been an anthropologist, studies cognitive systems, and recently, as I understand it, studies information flow through evolutionary processes. We also have Graham Spencer here with us. Graham, most importantly, is on the board of the Santa Fe Institute, but secondarily is a venture capitalist at Google Ventures, and he became so after selling a company that he had founded to Google, and that was just one of many businesses that he's been a part of building. Jonah Nolan is a personal friend. Very excited to have you here, Jonah. Jonah is from Los Angeles, and his discography and bibliography and what is television equivalent?
Cinematography.
We'll take that. Yeah.
His Scientology are extensive. But if you watch, for example, Westworld, or if you've seen The Prestige, or Memento, or The Dark Knight, or Interstellar, you've been lucky enough to enjoy Jonah's work, which deals with a great diversity of scientific and theoretical topics. And finally, but most importantly, trying to find your bio. Kurt Squire. Everyone give it up for Kurt Squire.
Yay.
And Kurt comes to us from UC Irvine, where he is a professor of informatics and studies in particular the potential of video game-based technologies to reinvent education in the way that we learn. Welcome our panel.
Fantastic. Is mic working? You can hear me? Wonderful. So I'm just delighted to be here with all of you and with this incredible group of people who I have huge admiration for. And we're just going to be discussing something that's very precious and very rare in the world, and that's intelligence, as opposed to stupidity, which, as Harlan Ellison said, is the second most common element in the universe after hydrogen. So hopefully we'll touch on both over the course of this discussion. And I'm going to kick it right off, and we'll just be covering a whole range of issues from the issues of intelligence at the individual level, how it's made possible by culture, how we fail and succeed in education, how we represent it to society, the nature of collective intelligence versus individuals, and on and on and on, and of course, AI. So, there are a few questions that are going to be targeted, and then there are going to be questions that are open. But I just want to start with Vanessa. Vanessa works on cumulative evolutionary processes. And so, Vanessa, sort of, what makes intelligence in our species or any species possible in the first place?
Well, first I want to say that there are many types of intelligence. So if I gave you 6,000 pine nuts and told you to go bury them in the Santa Fe forest over 100 acres, and then I told you come back in 1 year and go get them all, you would not be able to do that. But Opinion Jay would entirely beast that task because they have incredibly good spatial intelligence. So if you ask somebody to describe, if you pick somebody and say, tell me what intelligence is, I think a large part of what they'll say, what they'll do is they'll describe themselves. So if you ask a species to come up with a theory of intelligence, what you're going to get is a theory that tells you what their intelligence is. So when we're working with human intelligence systems, I mean, we have this like human-specific, human-centric view of what intelligence is. And I think that throughout this panel, in the back of our mind, we need to think about, well, what are other types of intelligence that are out there?
Yeah, and actually, so let me just move straight to Kurt on this, because you're an expert on technology, computation, mm-hmm. gaming, and education. And education is nominally that machine that we built to allow for the cumulative transmission of the best of our culture. Why is it so difficult? And are there prospects out there for doing it really well? And if we're going to send education out into space, what form of education are we going to be transmitting?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's built for that, but it's also not, right? So it's built also for sorting, which is a lot of what we do, is sorting who's going to get which jobs and which not. It's also for credentialing, right? We worry a lot about that. And then also, I think, enculturation. I think right now we're even seeing in particular maybe an understanding of the role that things like education, that even myself I'd love to slag on, or even like traditional media channels have done in enculturating us toward a common culture, so we have a shared understanding of things like what's factual and what's not. And education, for all of its kind of troubles, is something that's done that to a degree. But I think that where I'm particularly excited, but things it hasn't done, right? So things it hasn't done is done really any good at helping people, not any good, but it's not a system you would pick for developing passion, developing distributed expertise. You know, most learning systems, you'd think, well, I should probably become better than the teacher, or at least decide what I want to learn today before graduate school, right? Which is right now kind of the way it works. So a lot of my interest has been, how can we create new distributed kinds of systems? How can we create systems that look a lot more like the systems we have in the real world, where if I want to become an expert, like I'm a harmonica player, if I want to get better, I can do a lot in the real world between videos and affinity groups and so on. And so I think thinking about how we can create our next generation systems to do that, but that can take advantage of some of these systems, but then also maybe do better than them, because we also know the wild west of these learning systems can also be kind of weird, right? There's a lot of issues in terms of toxicity and how people treat each other that we may not want to emulate. But there's a whole bunch of opportunity, I think, right now.
But would you argue that, is it just a matter of time before the most intelligent way of becoming intelligent in a variety of different ways is by machine instruction as opposed to human instruction?
I think it's going to be a hybrid system. I mean, I think you're going to continue to see machines play a greater and greater role as various forms of coaches and things. But we know there is something particular to human bonds, and in particular to the way that we learn from and with each other. There are neurological studies, you know, looking at how you receive information and feedback from a valued mentor who is a kind of person that you emulate and care for. You know, a caring mentor is one of the most powerful things you can do. Again, it's ironic that in school we don't have them, right? Like, how many kids go, oh yeah, I go to school because there's a caring mentor. I mean, sometimes there's a teacher relationship. If you think back to your best experiences, that's usually what it is. There's a teacher that you cared for. Right. So I think that you're going to have a hybrid, but where you're thinking with machines being more coaches. I also do think there are some things we could probably do to have virtual, you know, agents that will help coach you and bring and give you a version of that experience relatively easily. But I don't think it's ever going to replace those human bonds.
So let's talk about the man on the panel who wants to replace the human bonds. The evil empire itself, Google, Graham Spencer. And Graham and I have had arguments over the years about this. So Graham is a total fanboy for neural nets and deep learning, and has been proven thus far to be completely correct, and I've been proven to be completely wrong. And so every task that I thought would just not be susceptible to the kinds of techniques that have been developed recently have yielded. And so I think, Graham, if you just maybe introduce a little bit some of these ideas of deep learning and how very simple reinforcement schemes have given rise to unbelievable success stories.
Sure. Thank you for that introduction. The basic idea with something like a neural net or with any machine learning system is that you give it a bunch of examples. So you show it a bunch of pictures of cows and a bunch of pictures of sailboats and a bunch of pictures of cats. And you have a carrot and a stick. And every time it makes the correct judgment, you give it a carrot. And every time it makes the wrong judgment, you whack it a little bit with the stick. And over time, it adjusts its internal numbers, its internal weights, and very slowly begins to learn the things that you would like it to learn. And for a long time, it was believed that that system was fine for learning really, really simple things, but could never possibly learn to actually identify images or to play the game of Go or to translate language. But what we've started to see is that through a combination of techniques, basically learning on the part of the researchers, and a combination of just massive computational scale, we found that lots and lots of things that we thought were not learnable turn out to be learnable in that kind of system. So now we have machines that can translate human language. They can identify images in a picture. They can even caption a picture. There are neural networks now where you can show it a picture and it will say, this is, you know, a young man riding a skateboard through the park, right? Things that even 10 years ago I think people would have thought were impossible are now definitely feasible.
Yeah. And so just to round this out, Jonah, I think Jonah writes the best scientifically informed science fiction screenplays in the world. So that's just, I think it's really true. And so, really. And so, okay, but I want to give two examples of where you've taken diametrically opposite approaches in your work, and I comment on these. So your robots in Interstellar, not in any sense anthropomorphic, but absolutely full of personality and humor. That's one group. And the other set in Westworld, who are increasingly terrifying us as the series progresses. And I know, because we were talking about this at dinner once, you spent about a year out of this world, out of your world, just reading the AI literature, just trying to give an accurate representation in a form that all of us can enjoy and really appreciate. I mean, just what are your thoughts in terms of communicating what AI is? And clearly, you're split on the matter.
Yeah, I think I find myself torn, as I imagine everyone up here is, on almost a daily basis between a sort of euphoric techno-optimism and a, you know, increasingly callous fear that all of our technologies will inherit all of our problems. We'll carry them along with us. In Interstellar, I had gotten tired of, I talked about this a little bit yesterday, you know, when introducing Forbidden Planet, because Forbidden Planet was probably the first on-screen depiction of an anthropomorphic robot in a capacity sort of, you know, coming with us to the stars, and it's a bracingly optimistic one. He's strong and capable and loyal. And then we went through the kind of Terminator phase of anthropomorphized robots that not coincidentally coincided with, you know, the emergence of robots as a genuinely disruptive force in the labor market, where you started having automotive factories with robots on the factory floor and people being displaced. And unsurprisingly, it sort of tilts towards a little more of that primal reaction to a competitive intelligence. I was interested with Interstellar in doing something that went back to that original idea, right? Of if it all goes the way we want it to, we design these intelligent agents who will come with us to the stars, there is no reason why they can't embody the very best behaviors and attributes that we ascribe to human behavior. They'd be loyal, brave, thoughtful, charismatic. And so with Interstellar, you kept waiting for the other shoe to drop. I said, no, you can trust these creatures more than you can trust the human crew members.
Yeah.
And then with Westworld, we kind of went a different, slightly different direction.
We're going to ask about what's going to happen, of course, and Jonah's going to remain silent. But I want to talk about this idea because I think it's very interesting. One of the issues that I know everyone here is interested in is, and Kurt raised it and Vanessa raised it, which is there's intelligence in the sense that we're all indoctrinated into thinking about, which is intelligence is IQ, right? Which is already a ludicrous test, but let's leave that aside. But we don't really talk about balletic intelligence much, we should. And musical intelligence, maybe. We describe Mozart as a genius in the same way we describe Einstein as a genius, which is interesting. But that's about it. And then there are these characteristics of empathy, as you say, loyalty, sanity. Why aren't we talking about artificial wisdom? And presumably, if we're going to go out into space, I mean, I don't think those aliens are going to be particularly impressed by AlphaGo. It's like, here's the best of humanity. It's like, really? And they're just going to take a torch to the Go board and say, that was pretty easy. And so I'm just curious, what do you all think about, Vanessa, you raised it with you first, you know, why don't we have empathy for these diverse forms of intelligence? I mean, why are we so obsessed with this one narrow analytical band?
Oh, that's a tough question. I mean, I would just say because we're self-centered. That's the only thing. I don't know where else to go with that.
What about other animals? What about the intelligence of other animals? And what we've learned about them and that, how that might enrich the debate.
I guess I would assume people and scientists would be interested in these other animal intelligence insofar as they're useful. So I know there's been a lot of attention to collective intelligence in ants and termites and stuff like that. Because termites, they seem to be doing something that's cumulative culture in a way. So I research cumulative culture. I want to point out that there's like two very different senses that you can understand cumulative culture. The first one is just the accumulation of things. So if you look around us, we have tons and tons and tons of things. It's a very like materialistic manifestation of what we think intelligence is. Mm-hmm. And that's the one thing that we can really point to and say is unique to humans. We got a lot of things, right? Mm-hmm. But the other sense of it, so the first sense is like society might have X number of person hours that we can spend making stuff. But the other sense is improvement upon what somebody else has already made. So that's cumulative in the sense that it produces outcomes that no individual could have created on their own. So I could just choose to spend my person hours on reinventing the wheel or adding something to the wheel. So these like termite mounds are good examples. Like no individual termite makes the whole mound. They kind of inherit this modified environment and add to it, and it produces like there's all these like emergent properties that come out of what a termite mound can do as a collective. So in a sense, I'd say that cumulative culture really underlies collective intelligence. So if we want to not talk just about human intelligence, but say something more generally about what is special that humans are doing that other organisms might be doing, like termites or other organisms on other planets might be doing, they might be tapping into this kind of collective intelligence. Mm-hmm. Like the stuff that I've learned, I can package that in some informational form. I can package my knowledge and give it to somebody else before I die. So that knowledge doesn't die with me. It stays out there in this public domain and then can be used for like to take more steps beyond that.
But let me look at since you've given the rosy picture of collective intelligence, let's look at the slightly less rosy version, which is, you know, horribly malicious chatbots or the
Go
sharing.
To Tucson right now.
Right.
You know, the thing going on in Tucson right now is crazy.
What is it? What is it?
Oh, there's a group of people that are convinced that there are homeless people trapping children and enslaving them for sexual purposes. And right now, they're convinced this is true. There's no, this is not happening.
So it's just a little bubble.
Yeah, but there are thousands of people who are dedicating hours to doing this and can't, see the obvious logical problem.
But that's the thing. So let's talk about that. And Graham, I know Graham has worked a lot on issues of bias in algorithms. And so if the data that's being collected is being generated by fallible human beings with all our prejudices, it's just going to reflect it right back at us in a more efficient manner, right? So what are your thoughts on that? I mean, so the negative side of Vanessa's comment of collective intelligence in the new tech world.
It's a huge problem. One of the best examples is in the field of machine translation, where a computer will take a whole bunch of snippets of text, for example, from the United Nations, where you have the same text in two different languages, and it will look for matching segments of text, and it'll build up a giant database, basically, of matching segments, and then when you feed a big sentence in, it tries to find the best matches and gives you a translation. But people really quickly noticed a big problem with that. So if you take a language like English, which has gendered pronouns, and you translate that into a language with non-gendered pronouns, and then you translate it back, so if you say, he is a doctor, she is a nurse, when that gets translated into the non-gender language, it's they are a doctor, they are a nurse. And when it comes back to English, it's right back to he is a doctor and she is a nurse.
Right.
And so it's preserving the gender biases of the source language in a way that people didn't really expect, but of course it's obvious in hindsight. And so figuring out how to address that is extremely difficult. I don't think anyone has a good answer right now, because it crops up in so many different ways. It crops up in facial recognition, where the databases for facial recognition are usually 80 or 90% white, and so they have a 5% accuracy on white male faces, but a 30% accuracy on black female faces. And in part that's because many of the researchers who do that work are themselves white males. In part it's because the database that they use is dominated by white male faces. But almost everywhere you turn, you find these issues. And I don't think anyone knows of a good solution yet, but it really does sort of crystallize and reflect back the biases that we already have.
It should,
How are you thinking about the ethics of once these things exist? like, and how they can be used for things you might plan for or not? Because that's been one of my concerns about all the things that we create, is that once they're out there, who knows what's going to be done with them?
It's a huge problem. I mean, today people can take, so this was a very controversial paper written, I think, just within the past year, where someone took a bunch of faces of criminals and non-criminals, and then tried to build a machine learning algorithm using a vision recognition system to identify whether someone's a criminal from their face. And of course,
yes, that's just phrenology.
Yes, 2.0, exactly. Right? Exactly. And anyone can look at that experiment and realize how incredibly biased and wrong that is. But anyone now can go download the toolkit to do that, and so it's sort of out there. People have done that also to detect sexual orientation, again, opening up an incredible set of problems, and the predictions are almost certainly completely inaccurate, but you can build the model, and you can run the model, and then you can believe the model, and that might make you do all kinds of things. Yeah. So it's really happening now.
Yeah. Can I ask, and Kurt and Jonah, in different ways of reaching out, you know, in a way you're both educators, it's an odd thing to say, but mm-hmm. But I think it's true, and you are exploring the hybrid domain, right, which is how a form of intelligence we think we know, our own, is interacting with one that we don't, that we created. And I'm just curious what your thoughts are on those hybrids and in your work how that plays out in different ways. I mean, for Kurt, what does the machine have to be human for us to empathize with it, or could it be unbelievably different? In fact, that might be preferable, actually.
Yeah.
And in your experience, you're writing about these things. Do they have to be human values? I mean, are there values we could admire and appreciate that are vastly different? I just riff on these kinds of ideas. Mm. I don't know.
I think anyone who's played, say, Final Fantasy VII, and the gamers out there know that you can care a lot about synthetic characters very quickly and easily. We do in games all the time. Mm. Super simple. Have a game, your character do something to help you, and then you usually feel a bond pretty quickly. We've been exploring ways to do these for other purposes. We're working right now, and as much as I am scared, I'm thinking, oh gosh, we're inventing something that could be scary. So we're working on creating virtual agents to help kids monitor their attention and their executive functioning, so ways to help them become better able to manage things like their attention. I do worry, though, at the same time, well, who gets those data? What do they do with them? Do teachers do it? Do parents do it? What happens when devices know your emotional state? One thing I'm committed to, though, is giving people the keys to that in the same way that I think we should be right now more broadly, like in the same way that you should be able to control what happens to your Facebook data and your Google data in ways that we have kind of given up. But it happens even in other systems, right? As a student, you could imagine saying we should be in charge of what happens with your test scores that you take and what the meanings are of that, and ability to be more of an advocate for yourself in our system. So that's something we've been trying to do, is to create social systems that go around that, so that we encourage people, as we come up with these devices, encourage kids to, say, be the ones to make the case for, here's what I think the meaning of this score is, or here's what I think the meaning of this is, so that I'm arguing with my data towards something. But I'd be lying if I said that we have it figured out.
Right, just jumping in on this question of empathy, which feels pretty foundational. Mm-hmm. We're going to need to build it into any form of AGI we contemplate. And for us, we, not on a theoretical level, but in a market-driven level, we had to grapple with the problem of empathy. We're doing a show about robots. Your show lasts only as long as the audience cares about the characters. And we struggled with it on a technical level in the first episode. During the notes process, when people would say things that you couldn't believe they would say, the whole project became kind of an acid test for the people we were working with in kind of frightening ways. But one producer at one point said, well, yeah, they get beaten up and assaulted and attacked, but if they don't remember any of it, does it really matter? Is there really a moral component to that? My wife, who worked in the DA's office and dealt with family violence with children who wouldn't remember the things that were done to them, had to point out that it was still a crime. Right. When we went in to manipulate the performances, largely we have an incredibly talented cast, and the actors who are playing hosts, who are the robots on our show, they would do an awful lot of acting, but we would do a little bit of subtle manipulation. We would slow down the way their facial muscles recovered from a blink. We would make the eyes move slightly independently. Really subtle stuff, and we had to be very careful with how much of it we applied. Humans are really weird when it comes to the question of empathy. I can draw a smile on a volleyball and build a very successful Tom Hanks movie out of it, where you feel really bad where the volleyball gets swept away by the ocean.
I didn't feel bad at all.
No, I didn't care. I didn't care. If it had been a basketball, I might have been more interested. You know, so humans are weird. I can trick you into applying empathy to something that does not deserve it in the slightest. So I have a daughter, and she has lots of stuffed animals, and she'd feel terrible if one of them came to any harm. We're very bad at applying it even to our fellow men. Right? Very easy for us to make a distinction. So getting into the mechanics beyond artificial intelligence, how do we sort things out? How do we understand things? This idea of artificial wisdom, artificial sanity, you know, the larger components of what it is to be intelligent, which includes empathy, is something I barely understand it in the human creature.
If we design that artificial wisdom, maybe that's the thing that'll kill the humans finally.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, that's it, you're out.
So let's ask sort of the elephant in the room, right, which is, you know, here we are at the Interplanetary Festival, and its ideas and its art and its positive and constructive, I hope. And yet we're living in a world which at the present time seems to be so riddled with prejudice and stupidity and intolerance. And it always has been, of course. But we seem to be going through a bit of a bad phase. And I'm just curious, you know, we're making so much progress in so many ways, right? I mean, every day you pick up the newspaper, something extraordinary has been discovered, someone's done some really amazing work. Why? What are we not doing? Where are we failing and why? Why isn't the culture, to Vanessa's point, why aren't we doing this cumulative culture thing? Why aren't these ideas getting out there to have an honest debate and to reckon with facts and come to a sort of a better resolution? What's going on in the world? Why is it so stupid?
Maybe I'll half answer that by harking back to what you were talking about, biases. And I'll give you some theoretical background for that as a cognitive scientist. Culture evolves by adapting to people's minds. It's something that replicates by passing through cognitive systems, through one mind, through another mind, like that. And in that sense, cognitive biases are selection pressures on culture. So if you can't learn something, for whatever reason, there's no way that you're going to be able to teach that, and that's going to fall out of your cultural domain. So you can't expect culture to solve these problems for you. You really need to change the landscape that culture is adapting to, which is our minds. And that's why language engineering is so bad. It doesn't work. There's a really good example. Actually, there's a couple examples. The word Ms., which was supposed to be a gender neutral, it was supposed to be a gendered way to refer to a woman, but not disclose her marital status. I actually saw some application forms from the 70s that had Ms. on there, and this was a new thing. A lot of people didn't know what it was, and they're like, why would someone not want to disclose their marital status? And I saw some applications that actually said Ms. parentheses divorced. And yeah. And nowadays, of course, we know, we don't use it like that. There's a lot of gender-neutral language, like chairperson is a really good example. Chairperson should not specify the gender of the person who's chairing a meeting. But if you go on Google Ngrams, you should Google that. This is a big database of word frequencies over time. If you type in, he is the chairperson, and then she is the chairperson, you'll have a flat line for he is the chairperson. Millions and millions, billions and trillions of words in English, nobody's ever said that phrase. But she is a chairperson, it's been rising with chairperson. So this is a gender-neutral word that people invented, but then they released it into a population of biased minds, and it just finds its niche. So we really need to change our minds before, we can't expect culture to do anything for us in this sense.
Right, that's great. Stupidity.
Stupidity. Where to even start? We talked a little bit about this. Fascinated by the idea of the Flynn effect, which suggests, for those of you not familiar with it, that over the 100 or so years in which there's been large-scale intelligence testing, that they have to renormalize every 10 years because the population seems to be getting smarter. Now, there's an enormous amount of questions under that. Are they just getting better at doing the test? You know, what do we mean when we say they're getting smarter? What does intelligence? You know, what do IQ tests even measure? But let's assume that on some level, the Flynn effect means that we're getting smarter. It's hard to imagine. I mean, you see a number of different explanations for it. One is nutrition, right? The Green Revolution, the idea that there's far more access to nutritive food possible. I do tend to think and wonder, again, going to the place of humans always tend to see it through their own lens, whether it's technical or something connected to our technological expressions of culture.
Yeah.
It seems to neatly rise, connect to the rise of television. Now, you know, the idiot box, ironically, might be part of this, you know, broadening of the ability for cultures to exchange information, for people to ideate back and forth, this kind of meta level of knowledge. If there is any connection to technological sort of underpinning to the Flynn effect.
It's video games, sorry.
It's clearly video games.
Yeah, yeah.
You asked the next question. I was very interested, David, in a talk you gave in LA last year. We talked about the idea that singularity actually began 70,000 years ago with the advent of spoken language and written language, and the idea that, you know, that intelligence is a shared phenomenon, that we ideate back and forth. And for me, the most urgent question right now is holding open the possibility that technology impacts that general level of intelligence. What's happening with social networking? You know, if that's where most of us are getting our information, if that's where most of us are now exchanging our ideas, those structures have been brought into place by market forces, right? So this larger question of what's ethical, what's sensible, what contributes to the overall good of it, I think is becoming a very urgent question. You can look at social networking as a dry run for artificial intelligence, because largely it's the same two companies who are driving both forward.
Yeah.
Facebook is the second, you know, biggest investor in intelligence behind Google in terms of artificial intelligence. If you look at social networking as a dry run, I think it's been a disaster, mm-hmm. right? I mean, we just look at the last year. Every day this week, there's another article about Facebook. So that larger question of the technologies we make, are they designed the right way to further the overall intelligence of the human species?
And it's really interesting, and it gets to this notion of collective intelligence, something that many of us are interested in at SFI, and that is, it's not obvious, right, that to create a collective intelligence, you just create lots of intelligent components. I mean, ants arguably have much more impressive collective intelligence than us, right, in some sense, but they're not individually more intelligent, so the mappings are rather complex. Now, I know we're running out of time, so I'm going to ask you this one final question, and it's a one-word answer. And that is, if we're going to send into space a species, animal or plant or microbial, that best represents the intelligence of evolution on the planet Earth, that's
ants.
A tough one. but you're going to have to send a colony, Jonah. Which species or individual representative of the species would you send? And I'm going to start, because I know you have to think about this. And it's obvious, and it's a cephalopod, obviously, and probably a giant Pacific octopus. That's mine.
I'd say a spore, because it has a lot of stain power.
A spore?
Yeah.
Of what species?
It's robust to everything.
I mean, what kind of spore?
Or also like a bacterium or something. Something that's just like proven that it's good for it on Earth, you know?
Oh, right. Okay, done. Yeah. And take them out when it hits them.
Yeah.
That's right. Graham.
I'm going to be totally speciesist and say a human. I'm going to do it.
All right.
I'm going to go with Douglas Adams on this one and say dolphin.
Nice.
You can't blow up a planet with dolphins.
Good.
That was mine. I could pick a different species. The bottlenose. The ant. I guess the for their collective ability to do work.
Yeah,
or bees, either one. I said ants, so go with it.
That works. Well, thank you very much to the panel. Thank you all very much. All right. Let's go. So, I think we're set. I think I stand up to introduce the next act now, and I think you guys can all bugger off. and so, now, I believe, if I'm not wrong, are we with Rob now? Where's my cognitive artifact support system? It is you, right, Rob?
That's correct.
All right, so I'll just say a few words, because you shouldn't really be leaving, because this next performance is so amazing. This is an individual who can make a sine wave make you cry. That's a very special power. He's an extraordinary musician. He's recorded with absolutely everyone you've ever heard of. He's worked with Simon and Garfunkel. He's worked with extraordinary experimental klezmer bands. He's worked with my namesake, actually, the lesser David Krakauer, the klezmer clarinetist. And he plays electronic instruments and just brings them to life. And the reason it's so fitting for Interplanetary is because these are the instruments that over all of our lives we've associated with science fiction in film. And of course, the most famous of which is that one, the Theremin. And so you're in for a real treat to stick around and listen to what will be an absolutely fantastic performance. Rob.
Give me one sec. Okay.
Right on. You feel good up there?
I feel good.
Right on.
I knew that I would. I hope that I might. You know what? Let's. Why don't we just play number 11 as long
as. Number 11? Cool, yeah, I was doing that. I want to take it back.
Yeah, what? Yeah, it's fine. It's just that thing is the one that we don't care about.
This is the Haken Continuum I'm going to be playing. Just, okay? Thank you. Thank you and good night. Okay. That was, I wasn't even going to play that one. Anyway, since I already seem to have started before I've started, let's consider that the sound check. Hi, I'm Rob. This is a Haken Continuum, which I was going to get to second, but since we seem to be here now, I'll just talk about this now. This is kind of really a cutting-edge instrument in terms of... Do all of you know what the theremin is to begin with? Sort of. I mean, we'll get to that. But so this is sort of like polyphonic theremin in a way, because each of your fingers, individual fingers, is like can be your theremin with volume and pitch and stuff like that, right? So let's just say, for instance, or something. Okay, so that's one finger. You can lean in or you can tap. It goes fast. It's ultra sensitive. And the technology is so happening that it disappears entirely when you're playing, and all you're left with is you're just playing, and it feels like an acoustic instrument, sort of. Which might not seem to be the most easy for me to say, technologically advanced instrument, but here it is. So like I was just playing, you know, because the Beatles tune, it's got several voices. They can all, you know, move separately, this, that, the other thing. Okay, anyway, I'll come back to that. And now we can go on with our previously... whatever it is. Thank you. Okay, so this is the theremin. The theremin is the only instrument you play without touching. There's two electromagnetic fields around it. On this side, controls the volume as you get closer to this antenna. On this side, it gets louder as I lift away. Inside is an oscillator, which is a large Central American cat. And now, you can hear this as I get... Okay, so there's like that. Now, we're used to things being louder when they're down, or more is down. Gas pedals, volume pedals is always down. So this was invented 100 years ago by a Russian guy, back when they didn't know that louder was down. We've obviously become much smarter over the last 100 years. And, you know, okay, never mind. Okay, so I'm going to continue with some other music on the theremin.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks. I just wrote that. No, I'm lying. That was David Bowie's Life on Mars. You know, I was thinking about songs that would be apropos, you know, not Edgar Allan apropos, but something for this, and I realized that there's all these songs with these references, but if nobody knows them, it doesn't matter whether they're about space or not. So I just decided I was going to do space-like songs. Of course, playing on this instrument, there's not a whole lot else you can... Well, maybe there is. We'll see. Anyway, like I said, you don't have to... You don't touch this. And you don't have to wash your hands before you play. And my son thought this artist's name was Carlos Antenna when he was a little boy. And I thought that would be a good stage name. Thank you. Okay, if you have license plate, no, that's the wrong thing. Okay, gonna move along. This is something that I just, also another track that I just made. This is, does anybody remember Outer Limits, Twilight Zone, One Step Beyond, that stuff? Okay, this was, there was a guy named Harry Lubin who wrote music for all of those things, and this is one of his kind of, if you think of it in a kind of black and white sci-fi romantic kind of way, it sort of might make sense, might not, but it is indeed space-oriented, at least is meant to be. This will be track number 3 on the hit parade. This is called Celestial Bodies. See, so I rest my case.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move over to the continuum. And just do a little freestyle and see what happens.
Thank you.
Thanks. That last piece was actually a piece by Messiaen. Some people know it from the quartet, The End of Time, but before it was done on piano and cello, it was actually written for four Hans Martinos, which are monophonic instruments, so it took six of them to do that. But because this instrument is cool, I could do it all at once. And I don't have to pay those other guys. Let me move back over to the theremin for a little bit. Okay. Hey, does anybody know who Ema Sumac was? Was that one person? Okay, Ema Sumac was this fantastic singer with like a 5-octave range. And she was, you know, really famous in like the 50s. She was in this movie called Treasure of the Incas or something like that with Charlton Heston, shot in Machu Picchu in 1952. And this song is from that. And it's called number 5. It's called Ate Pura, which means whatever you like, whatever you want to think it means.
Give me 1 second so I can...
Okay, well, listen, since we're an intimate crowd, what do you think? Okay, so we have a choice between Lost in the Stars by Kurt Vile, which is, you know, stars, and it's applicable. The other one is the theme from The Day the Earth Stood Still, which is also applicable. Or we could just do both of them. What do you, any choice? Nah, no, okay. All right, we'll do both. Okay, so that would be number six. Six and right into number seven, I guess. Okay, so remember, we're lost in the stars. So that's the first thing. Then the day the Earth stood still. And I have that, since Bernard Herrmann wrote that, he also wrote the music to Vertigo. So this goes right into, that goes right into Carlotta's Portrait from Vertigo. So if you're wondering what the second piece after The Day the Earth Stood Still. Okay, blah, 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 blah. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks. Anybody have any questions, by the way? Just quick, any quick questions? I'll tell you this. This is, it's not as easy as it looks. You know, you're not touching anything, and so every other instrument, you know, you have some kind of tactile reference, you know, you feel something. This, within this electromagnetic field, you feel nothing. There is no feedback whatsoever other than hearing that you're right or you're wrong and adjusting to that. Question back there. I can't hear a word. What was that again? My favorite composition for Theremin. Oh, I don't know. I mean, there's really not that many pieces that were written exclusively for the Theremin. Most of the pieces are adaptations of, you know, vocal music or this or that. So, you know. Well, the Day the Earth Stood Still is pretty good. Why not? What was the other Spellbound? You know, I mean, those are the most famous things. You know, people think Good Vibrations is a theremin. That's fine if they want to. Hey, does it? By the way, since we're talking about that, do you like the Beach Boys at all? Le Garçon de la Plage? No. All right. You know the song God Only Knows? Should I try that? I'll try. I think I could do that. Well, God only knows if I could do that, but let's try it. Okay. We have the first vote is in. That's a not a thumbs down. It's a something down. Okay. It's a flack. Okay. Anyway. Okay. So let's try God Only Knows, and we'll God only knows how it'll go. That's number 13. Lucky number 13.
10 minutes.
Okay.
Thank you.
thanks. Let's go to number four, and I'm going to go over here. Thanks. That was called Stepping Out. Eric Clapton played that with John Mayall and the Blues Breakers, 1965. Okay, last thing. This is the love scene from Vertigo, Bernard Herrmann. And that's that. Oh, if anybody's interested, I have CDs for sale over there, and by then I'll stop bending over like this. Thanks. Number 10. Take two. Thank you. Thanks for all being here, and thanks for the company.
Hi, everyone. That was amazing, yes. That was awesome. I just have a few announcements before we get to our social and economic engineering panel. I want to, again, point your attention to this row of tents. These are a collection of artists from all over the state of New Mexico who have produced cosmodities, which are interplanetary-themed commodities that you can all take home as souvenirs this evening. I also want to point your attention at the very end of this expo, one of our partners in Futurition, Axel Contemporary, is showcasing an exhibition. They're actually debuting it here called Iris by Stephen Auger, who was just inside the Farmers Market Pavilion for that body hacking, biohacking panel earlier this morning. I also want to say that Haim Benaroya, who was part of the Living in Space panel that opened this up, and who just gave a private presentation or a solo presentation on lunar settlements and his work therein, is actually signing books under the water tower, a book that he wrote about his work designing lunar settlements. So if you're interested in doing that, please do that. Also, Rob Schwimmer, as he mentioned, is selling CDs in the water tower right now as well. Coming up soon, well, not soon, but I'm just going to let you know in case you want to buy your tickets. Scott Ross, who was one of the founders of Digital Domain and also worked at ILM, who is a kind of a digital effects superstar, I'm responsible for the effects in Fifth Element, which he introduced last night. He will be introducing a special screening of Terminator 2 Judgment Day at Violet Crown tonight at 8 p.m. It's a very intimate screening. There are a few tickets remaining. I highly recommend that you buy them up. And yeah, stay tuned at 6 o'clock, right across the tracks. Currents New Media opens for their 9th year. And I guess that's all I have for now. But thank you all for being here. The last day of our very first Interplanetary Festival. See you next year. But stay here.
That's an interplanetary challenge. So, I'm delighted to introduce this next panel on social and economic engineering of the future, hopefully with a very positive connotation of engineering. And let me just briefly introduce the panelists. And so here on my left is Jessica Flack. Jessica Flack is a professor at the Santa Fe Institute who works on collective computation. So how, when many individuals come together, they produce emergent properties whereby you can treat a society almost as if it were a circuit board. And respecting, of course, the agency of the individual components. Sitting further down from her is, now not in, out of order, is Rob Gershaham. And Rob started his career as a book editor at Simon & Schuster, and then saw the light, and moved into virtual and augmented reality. He's worked with a huge number of very well-known companies, Prodigy Services, Scholastic, Sony, Viacom, and most interestingly, he was the director of the Institute of Play. And Rob has a very intriguing attitude towards the sort of iconoclastic treatment of discovery. And sitting by him is the great writer, Cory Doctorow. Yay. And Cory is many things. Cory is an activist. He's someone who's thought extremely deeply about the modern world in which we live, the open source movement, the control and dissemination of information. And his novels and books and blog posts and so on reflect those interests. Most recently, his wonderful novel, Walk Away, which means, yes, you can, I guess. But including in real life and information. Information doesn't want to be free, which is a twist on a famous false remark. And sitting next to him is the wonderful, the inimitable, the only, the extraordinary D.A. Waller, who you've met, of course, introducing some of these sessions. D.A. Is hard to describe. He started off learning, I don't know, he speaks several languages, he spent a lot of time in Africa, working with a number of different communities, then became a rock musician, appears in the film La La Land, and for some reason, something happened to DA, and he now he's, what is a venture capitalist? I don't know, man, you have to explain yourself. But he's doing venture capital for good and has become an extraordinary expert in molecular biology, nanotech, and the interface between those principles and inference and machine learning. So it's an amazing panel. Take it away, Jess.
Okay. Well, welcome, everybody. Hope you're having a good time in Interplanetary. So what I want to do is start just with a few minutes, like 2 or 3 minutes of context to ground the discussion. And the first thing I want to say is that human history is actually replete with examples of attempts to orchestrate social outcomes and to engineer social interactions. And a great example comes from New Mexico itself, from Chaco Canyon. Another example is the Balinese water temple system that emerged in the 9th century in Southeast Asia. And there you have amazing, iconic, stylized monuments and the evolution of all sorts of elaborate rituals to control planting cycles and water distribution. Another example, a very different kind of example, is of course voting systems. A really interesting one comes from Venice. It was a voting protocol, incredibly opaque, Rube Goldberg-like voting protocol that was invented by these feuding Venetian families in the 1500s to make the election of the Doge tamper-free. So these are all examples of what I would call social engineering, but of course, if you are an actual engineer, you might balk at that definition or balk at those examples. Because social engineering is not particularly precise. It certainly hasn't been. And it's not at all like designing a cell phone tower or a spaceship or a car or a grain for milling, a water wheel for milling grain. You know, it's very different. There's no meticulously drawn blueprints. There are no objective tests that we can use to decide whether a particular social intervention is actually going to work to change things. And in fact, it's largely been based on human intuition about cause and effect. And then based on our understanding of what those cause and effects are, trying to manipulate them to change things. So for example, if crime goes up, we build more prisons and increase our police force, right? So it's kind of post hoc, retro, looking back, and based on intuition. And so you could say that so far in human history, social engineering has been what we call, or what I have called in our work, largely reactive instead of proactive, right? And the reason for that, one of the reasons that this has been the case, is because we haven't really had fantastic, fine-grained data on individual behavior. But as you all know, as you have gained a glimmer of, no doubt, with the Cambridge Analytica Facebook debacles, that is beginning to change. It's not clear how it will change yet, but it is definitely beginning to change. And we are getting, for the first time in human history, incredibly detailed data on human social interactions. We're getting great data on humans in groups, and we're getting data on how collective decisions are made. So the world is about to change, I would say. And the question is, now with this digital technology and that great data, are we in a position to maybe engineer social outcomes from the bottom up with quantitative principles? And this is an important concept, one that we can certainly employ on Earth now, and maybe take off Earth as we explore new worlds. And the question is, given that we have this opportunity, maybe the time has come to really think hard about it, to think outside the box, to think about how what we could do, what would be possible if we weren't limited by our own imaginations. So that's what we're going to talk a little bit about today. And before we jump into the discussion, these guys, I think, are just going to say a minute or two about their own backgrounds and their maybe make a provocative statement or give their perspective on this issue. So why don't we just go down the line?
Okay. Can you all hear me? Okay. So as David said, I was working in the book industry and then saw the light into digital technology, and specifically games. And for many years, I was interested in games as sort of an emerging art form, essentially a form of fiction. But the past 15 years, it's been clear to me that they are a form of social experimentation, especially as games became social and connected. And so they become, for me, an interesting way to sort of do social engineering, but social understanding, and at different timescales. So while we may have the real-time world of Cambridge Analytica, it's possible to do experimentation, to think of game-like environments as terraria for exploring the future. So that's of great interest to me.
So I'm a science fiction novelist, and that means that I often think about predictive power of different kinds of imaginative exercises. And I have the conclusion that science fiction has virtually no predictive power. I think science fiction writers are basically Texas marksmen. We like to fire a shotgun into the side of a barn and then draw a target around the place where our pellets went in and then tell everyone what a great shot we are. But science fiction does some other interesting and useful things. It's kind of obvious on its face that science fiction is a really good inspiration or warning. You know, all appearances to the contrary, George Orwell did not intend 1984 to be a manual for statecraft. You know, it was meant to be something of a warning. People get inspired. Paul Krugman became an economist because he thought Harry Seldon and Asimov's books seemed like a cool dude. But that warning and inspiration is itself, I think, just sort of the first order effect. The more interesting second order effect is the diagnostic power of science fiction. So if you want to know what a science fiction writer is secretly worried about or hopeful for, read what they've written. If you want to know what the world is secretly hopeful for or fearing, read what they're reading. You know, find out what's on the bestseller list. Mary Shelley's book is 200 years old, and we're still reading it. We're reading it probably for different reasons than they read Frankenstein 200 years ago. But the fact that we're now really worried about runaway technology becoming our master instead of our servant tells you a lot about where we are today. And so I'm interested in what are futuristic stories about social control say about our beliefs about human behavior and where we're going and where we're coming from.
Since David framed my transition to venture capital investing as a little paradoxical, I guess I'll just defend it for a second, and maybe that's a good way to explain myself. Broadly speaking, if you're investing other people's money, the goal is to give them more money back than they gave you. And I tend to think that there are two ways of doing this. One is you either identify things in the world that you think are extremely unlikely to change, and you place bets on those things, and that's probably the best way to reliably make money. And then the second is to make predictions about what things, if they existed, people would spend a lot of their money on. And that is, I think, inherently a project of social engineering. So the companies that I try to back are companies that have a new idea about how we should do something, and they're either vindicated or discredited when they actually give people the option to say yes or no to that experience. Over time, of course, my hope is to get better and better at predicting this, but the more I've done it, the more obvious it becomes that it's a really difficult thing to do. Predicting in general is really hard, and as Jessica said, social engineering is extremely imprecise. However, I guess what gives me hope is that all of these changes in human behavior tend to begin with some act of creativity, whether that's the proposal of a new scientific theory or an explanation of something, or by creating an experience that people can participate in and then choose to. And it just doesn't happen unless people give it a shot. So there needs to be a source of new ideas. And for those new ideas to become important in our society, driven as it is so much by economic activity, those have to be ideas that people can participate in economically.
All right, awesome, guys. So let's actually dive into that a little bit and think about this question of limits. I think one question we might ask is, are the current social institutions that we have, are they the best there is, the ones that we've seen over human history, for example? Or are they a consequence of the sort of constraints that actually Earth has placed on us, natural ecology and so forth, our brains maybe? And to what extent are they also the limits of our imagination?
So I'll go first. I feel like it's probably self-evident that they're probably not the best that there ever will be. They're defined by conditions here, past and present. And when we talk about social engineering as an distributed interplanetary society, there are going to be new conditions. The question is, will we reflexively seek to impose old models on new conditions in a context where the cost of failure is very high, where these settlements and fragile environments will collapse if it's wrong?
So there's this sort of trade-off between doing what you know works,
right,
and being exploratory. And of course, you sort of know that what works might work for our brains, for example, in the way sort of that we interact with each other, but maybe not in a new ecology.
Right.
So how do you balance that? I mean, especially when the cost, like you say, if we go to Mars or something, is really high of getting it wrong.
Right.
Well, you know, I think that when we think about engineering problems, we can cleave them into two halves. One is whether we've designed a system that works well, and one is whether we've designed a system that fails gracefully. Mm-hmm. And when you say something best or worst, or is it as good as it can be, and what are its constraints? I mean, a system that works very well but fails to adapt to changing circumstances its lack of graceful failure is probably like a deal breaker, right? Because you know it doesn't matter how much general prosperity you produce during the golden years if you are all drinking your urine and digging through rubble looking for canned goods in 10 years, right? Like mm-hmm. you kind of want a soft landing as well as a great voyage on the way. My concern about any or all of the ways that we contemplate off-planet civilizations or off-planet societies is that they all seem to have these authoritarian underpinnings. You know, either they're conceived of in an explicitly military construct. We have words like captain as part of the kind of construct, and you see this in Heinlein and other science fiction of the age, where oftentimes there's someone who's like literally wearing a sidearm and shouting, "It's lifeboat rules!" whenever anyone questions their authority, like, because we're all in a lifeboat, we don't know how much longer we've got, I'm the only one who knows how to steer the lifeboat, you do what you're told or I shoot you and toss you overboard. And you know, whether or not there are times in a lifeboat where you need to do that, for a certain kind of person, sinking the ship so that you all get in the lifeboat and you get to shout lifeboat rules whenever anyone disagrees with you might be an awfully attractive proposition. Or, you know, we're talking about, you know, Iron Man sending us all to Mars in our Teslas. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that is a guy who, by all accounts, is the world's shittiest boss. And, like, the idea that we'll just all subject ourselves to his management style, it's, you know, it's a kind of, like, off-world, no-escape Sartrean vision of the original vision for Disney World, where you'd have a dome and everyone would live there and Walt Disney would replace the Bill of Rights with a set of employment terms that would involve not swearing, not having a mustache, you know, like, all of his kind of, everyone has to drink Tom Collins instead of Caprinos or something, you know, like, those kind of weird aesthetic ideas that rich weirdos come up with and declare to be natural laws.
So part of this, I guess, is having a kind of fluid organizational structure. So I think we had some discussions with NASA once where they were talking about actually the problem of getting to Mars over 10 months. And part of it is, you know, a standard kind of NASA mission where you need that command style organization that they drew from the military. But part of it's a science expedition. Yeah. And they need to be able to shift in us, you know, in over those 10 months between these two very different organizational structures. And so how do you design that? What kind of team is the right team that can go between these two very different states?
I mean, I think a really interesting real-world example of social engineering is the American Civil Rights Movement, which over decades navigated between a number of different organizational structures. So you had grassroots, you know, decades-long legal campaigns going on to try and elucidate the ways in which the law was being misinterpreted to produce social outcomes that were obviously unjust to the people who were critiquing them. You also had sort of galvanizing leadership in the form of folks like Martin Luther King or Malcolm X or others who appeared to be almost dictatorial figures, but who stood on the shoulders of thousands of grassroots volunteers who were actually changing people's perceptions. Right. And the other thing that I think is really interesting about the civil rights movement or the suffragette movement, you can talk about movements elsewhere in the world, is that they were efforts at social engineering that didn't begin from some idealist vision of the future. They began from a place of identifying obvious problems and injustice. Mm-hmm. And when I look out at the world, I think there are so many things that are obviously mistaken in the way we do things that, given our limited time, better to start with those. Let's triage the things that we know don't work and just make them a little bit better, at least. I think where we often in the past, as we have thought about ourselves as doing social engineering, have erred is by saying, you know, throw out everything. And we have some picture in some guy's book of exactly what it should look like.
That's a nice example, DA. But let me tell me a little bit more about it, because what it sounds like is that, of course, there wasn't a big vision for the civil rights movement that was conceived at the beginning. It was these personalities and aspects that sort of filled a niche that developed as the civil rights movement grew. And so it's reactive in the sense that I was suggesting in the introduction, like many of the examples that we have. Instead of proactive, and there's an idea in evolution called niche construction, where basically organisms, humans included, go out and modify the environment. They change the selection pressures they're subject to, and therefore they sort of control the future and can predict the future a little more. It's very proactive. Are there any elements that we can take from the like civil rights example that have that kind of proactive feature?
Well, I think you get into causality in some sense, because the question is, if you twist this knob in the society, what happens? You know, there are certain laws that are obviously pretty clearly connected to their outcomes. Mm-hmm. So if, for example, you have a law that prohibits black people from voting, you can be relatively confident that more black people will vote if you make it legal for them to do so. And so, you know, I think you start with that kind of low-hanging fruit, and then it gets more complicated when you get into issues that currently surround issues of racial justice in America, for example, around what different sentencing laws will do in the way of outcomes in a specific neighborhood where, you know, the product may be the result of a lot of different processes that's just one part of.
I think maybe the distinction that you guys are trying to work to is tactics and strategy, right? I mean, I think that there was a vision, right? You know, MLK was a socialist who believed in a kind of egalitarian outcome. That was the thing he was headed towards. This is the thing that the long arc of history is bending towards in his view. And then he has a bunch of tactical ideas for how to accomplish it, as do his colleagues. And I think that this is where, like, our discussions about, well, do we want a decentralized or a centralized system sometimes break down, because the answer is, for what, right? When the principles elucidated in the Constitution serve us well for achieving whatever goal it is we want, then we're all strict constitutionalists. When we're worried about the Three-Fifths Compromise, the Constitution is an unfit document that needs to be revised from time to time in order to improve it. You know, the obvious one is... Democrats love executive authority when there's a Democrat in the White House, and they love states' rights when there's a Republican in the White House, and they hate states' rights when states are passing voter suppression laws, and they love states' rights when states are preserving Obamacare and mandating net neutrality,
yes, right? Welcome.
So, but the way to resolve that conundrum is not to say, well, you have an ideological incoherence as to whether you like states or the central government making your rule. The ideological coherence is, I want net neutrality or universal healthcare or socialism or universal justice, and whatever tool in the moment serves that is the tool I want to use. And if my adversary can use it to weaken my goals, right? The reason we have the rules of the game is to produce an outcome that we want, not because we want to have a fun game, and maybe that's the difference between games as a kind of purely ludic exercise. Although you sometimes get this, like, you know, people who play pool like jerks, right, who just push, go all in on every hand in order to intimidate everyone else. You know, those people, like, if you're at the table, or not pool, poker, if you're at the table, you're like, dude, it's a friendly game, and you're ruining it, right? And they're like, well, it's in the rules. Everyone hates those people.
Right. Seems to me there are three, so think about this, there are almost three domains that have different possible considerations for a social engineering piece. And one is kind of why we're here today, which is how do we actually re-energize and galvanize society to value the whole question of we as a species becoming interplanetary. Mm-hmm. And that's one set of activities which I think is really interesting and at hand. The second one is sort of the what I'd call the intermediate phase, which is the journey out, right? And there where you get into the captain's rule, the lifeboat rules, you know, where it's still very fragile, still exploratory. And then the third phase is, okay, things are more or less established. And now what are the relationships of those societies? It's interesting we call them colonies. That has an implicit colonial meaning. Let's just call them settlement societies, something else. And what is their relationship to the mothership now? And that's really the complex, interesting, and probably conflict-ridden future.
I think you skipped a step, because you started with, we all want to unite as a species to get off planet. But I think there's at least two camps. One is, we all need to get off this planet before we use it up, because we can't possibly not use it all up. Right. And if we use it all up in the process of getting off the planet, at least we got off the planet before we used it up, which is a certain circularity to it.
Right.
Right? And then there's the, like, well, we need to get off this planet so that we can learn to be better stewards of our own planet. And, like, that eventual relationship is in large part dictated by why we go.
Yeah.
Let me push back a little bit. So, two things are different about the future, right? One is what I said in the introduction, and that is that we have at our disposal potentially incredible data that we've just not had before, so we could have quantitative principles guiding our social engineering. And the other is that we will be going off-planet, right? These are two big things, right? And so you guys are presenting a very coherent sort of picture of the things that we might take into account, the steps we might pass through. But again, there's this question of, are we really challenging ourselves? What are the limits of our imagination? Should we have that discussion? How can we identify what those limits might be? What are strategies we can use to reveal these biases?
Good question.
Put you on the spot.
Well, I actually think this morning's panel on living in space was a good peek at some of the things that have to be considered. You know, Antarctic missions where strangers are in close quarters. You know, it's just one example. So I think there's a lot of rehearsal that can happen here to suss out at least
counterfactuals.
And yeah, and suss out part of the things. The desire to I forget how it was said, but let's make sure we transmit the data back from these expeditions on Earth. Or if it's a SEAL team or whatever, that we capture that data so that experiential knowledge can be transmitted in a meaningful and quantitative way. I think that's a way to start. I don't know if that gets at the question.
Well, what about video games?
And video games are a way to approximate certain types of things, absolutely. I mean, a famous simple example that's roughly in the domain is the pandemic in World of Warcraft, where a virus was introduced and behaviors could be observed. And so games are a very data-rich environment. And so that's why I brought it up in the first place. Not so much because of the gameplay, but because of the data that's generated and available.
I guess one of the questions you've raised, Jessica, is whether we should embrace the possibilities afforded to us by the sensorization of the world and our higher fidelity ability to measure what's going on. And, you know, I think there's some debate among people who think about this stuff, maybe you're one of them, as to whether or not these sort of systems are even in theory modelable and interrogable in an empirical way.
Absolutely.
I would like to bet that they are, because most other things that we've tried to measure have turned out to be.
That's SFI.
That's SFI. I think what's important, though, and maybe missing, particularly in the Silicon Valley world that I sort of inhabit, is a level of humility about how quickly and completely we learn and understand things and what it does mean to understand something. And, you know, we were talking before the panel, there's a history of science and politics is littered with misunderstandings that we essentially overreacted to. And so, you know, we believe in things like phrenology or other, you know,
eugenics.
Now silly ideas, eugenics. Mm-hmm. And then we invest so deeply in them and we try to build our world around them. So we should have some sort of provisional holding period that we subject new knowledge to. When we think we've figured out how something works, we could start doing some fun, you know, sort of skunk works projects with it, but we shouldn't immediately vote out every president in the world and ask for new people to implement the crazy brand new theory. Which, you know, is sort of inherently a bit conservative, but I think it's conservative in the right way. It's a question of what does modesty look like as a governing principle for our civilization?
Can I propose that we actually do have a model for a civilization in which people have to live for a very long time in close quarters with limited contact with the outside under very strict rules? It's prisons. Right? They're fully surveilled. We have tons of data about them. We're not very good at predicting how prisoners will behave. It turns out that human behavior is like super adversarial. The people who want to influence or control or persuade people to behave in a certain way need to contend, first of all, with people who, a second power block or multiple power blocks that want the same people to behave in a different way. I want the voters to vote for me, and you want the voters to vote for you. And then there's the voters, right, who themselves are adapting and thinking and have their own set of priorities. And one of the things that we know about persuasion and other forms of social engineering is that it's dynamic and that tactics that worked stalemate really quick, mm-hmm. right? I was saying before, if you go around Santa Fe, you'll see on the sides of the old brick buildings signs, you know, ghost ads, buy Pear soap, 5 cents, it will make you clean. And there was a time when apparently that sold soap, right? And now it's like, Axe body spray will make you a love god. Because, like, we developed a callus over the part in our attention or mm-hmm. our persuadability that where it will make you clean seemed like, well, they wouldn't say it would make you clean if it wasn't true. They wouldn't let them put it on a building if it wasn't true, certainly. You know. And now we're like, well, it's probably a lie, right? And so, you know, we see this with all persuasion techniques. Even if we stipulate that Cambridge Analytica's marketing material should be taken at face value, and they are in fact Svengalis who can make you believe that up is down and black is white, and that they were making normal people into racists instead of just finding racists and making them into voters, even if you believe that that's the case, there's no reason to believe that they can do it again next year, mm-hmm. right? Maybe it's a one-off.
I don't know if it's a one-off, but it's certainly early days.
Right.
Certainly early days. I mean, okay, so maybe one more set of issues before we take a question or two. Is it naive to think that in settling, say, another planet, that we'll essentially have the opportunity to really start over? Is that naive, or, I mean, are there reasons to believe that these will be very isolated settlements? And where there'll be memory, of course, of human history and human institutions, but it will decay.
I think it will decay over time. I think it really depends on how sort of communication is preserved between Earth-based societies and other societies. And that's still very problematic and to be determined.
You know, I think that we wouldn't want it to not decay in as much as we'd want it to be dynamic because its circumstances would change, mm-hmm. right? You know, they're not like LARPing day one of the colony for the next 1,000 years, right? They, like, if there's other people on other planets and new technologies and new social movements and pandemics and whatever, you know, they're going to have to adapt. So, you know, I think that it's instructive to look to the project of framing the U.S. Constitution, where you have these radicals who wanted to create a static system that would still flex a little, right? We want to radically tear down everything. We want to set up a set of principles. They should never change, except very slowly and incrementally through these things like constitutional conventions. So they were pretty damn sure of themselves.
And it
right?
had a big impact, actually. Cultural and history of the Constitution is very influential.
Yeah, yeah. And it's like it's a thing that a lot of people do when they constitutionalize, and you see people trying with various success to try and do it with free software projects or online communities. it almost never happens in games. Right. You know, games have this like problem that they're, unless we're talking about an old school MUD, they're super authoritarian. Right. You know, in the same way that jokes are authoritarian, you don't get to vote on when the punchline gets told. In a game, you don't get to vote on when the dungeon master puts the orc in front of you. Like, that's the dungeon master's job is to, your job is to like decide which dungeon master you want, and their job is to tell you where the orcs are. And so, you know, games are like super anti-democratic in that way.
I think it would be really dumb for us to start fresh. And the reason for that is that we've come up with a lot of cool stuff. And we also have a lot of evidence about the
like
things
the
that we can do. So you put us in certain circumstances, and unfortunately we can all, it seems, turn into Nazis. You put us in other circumstances, and it turns out we can sing Kumbaya and hug each other and worship the Rajneesh. And so I think, like, we think of technology as gizmos and gadgets, but it, of course, encompasses everything that we do and the ideas that we have and social norms. And those things serve to sort of put us in a cage to ensure a certain amount of good behavior and limit bad behavior, but also hopefully not so restrictive a cage that we can't flourish as people or as societies or create new ideas. And I think that general framework of wanting to keep ourselves from being bad but allow ourselves to explore and invent should also govern the way that we would move anywhere else. I think it would be terrible if we saw that as the beginning of history.
Okay, awesome. Maybe we have time for one question. Yeah.
Do you want to rephrase it, Jessica,
so the question,
audience
doesn't know? Do you want to?
So I think it's a criticism of both capitalism and communism. Is that correct? And you want a better system? Oh, wait for the train to go by. A better system in which workers get out what they put in. That's more maybe emphasizes equality more, equality of effort.
So look, I think everybody wants to declare what they've done to be a unique act of creation and that all the things that they used to do it to be mere plumbing that anyone could have come up with. I don't know that you could ever calculate the part that the worker did or the part, you know, that any one individual put in. This is the problem with measurement is that it pretends that it's measuring all the important things. And generally what it measures is the thing that the person who's doing the measuring is pretty good at because that's the number they want to look that they want to make big and reify. When we're talking about performance measurement, you know, the reason we allocate resources at all is because we don't have enough. Having enough, we talked earlier when we were planning this about scarcity and abundance. Having enough is a matter of making things very well, which we're getting very good at, choosing what we want, which we're less good at, and then distributing what we have, which we're really, really bad at. And it may be that if we fix one of those other two things, all of the questions about fair allocation go away. We don't worry about fair allocation of air, right? We don't worry about fair allocation of, well, now we're worrying about fair allocation of sex, right? This is a kind of weird thing that happens when you start to complain about, when you make allocation the big question is you start to say, well, why can't I buy a kidney? How come some people get to have sex and other people don't? Why can't rude, obnoxious, and objectionable people have sex? You know, like this is this. There's now a terrorist movement grounded in this that just killed 10 people in Toronto. You know, so I don't know that allocation and fair shares are the right thing. Maybe abundance is the right thing.
I would just say because we discussed it before the panel. Cory brought up I don't know if you were quoting him, but the philosopher Slavoj Zizek says this thing that for us to sort of illustrate how ideology laid in our minds are that it's more sort of easy to envision the end of the universe than the end of capitalism. And I guess when you think about these two systems opposed to each other, as you did in the question, what maybe we forget is that the future almost certainly is going to be characterized by new ideas that don't yet exist. And as a technologist or as an investor, I'm always looking for the fountains of those new ideas. I think at least for this crowd, since we're in America right now, it's important to recognize that China is producing right now some phenomenally interesting and new ideas, some of which are terrifying and some of which are just sort of like, huh. And they view themselves as instantiating socialism, quote unquote, with a Chinese character, which to sort of Jessica's framing comments involves a granularization of the way that workers are measured and people's behaviors in the society are tracked and rewarded or punished. And so whether we want to bring that into reality or not, they are. And I think it's incumbent upon those of us in the West or in traditions that prioritize the individual in a way that China, say, doesn't, respond with equally new ideas that speak to the deficiencies of our traditions and offer a counterpoint to the proposals that they're making to the rest of society.
All right, excellent. Guys, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
All right. Okay, so the star has arrived. And this is Van, who spoke yesterday in quantum field theory and physical theories of time. And this is Minivan. And Minivan has something very important to say, don't you, my friend? Ready? One, two, three.
Space is cool.
Yes, give it up for Minivan. Space is cool. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. All right. Okay, so let me introduce the panelists. Not as cool as Minivan, but cool. I'll start here with Seamus Blackley. Now, Seamus disappointed us at Interplanetary this year because he was going to bring Richard Feynman's van. And for those of physics geeks covered in Feynman diagrams, and he tried, to be fair, he tried, but he couldn't work it out because it was too precious, and driving that thing, you'd have sort of Green's function strewn all over the highway. But Seamus Blackley, that's a sort of physics joke, is known as the father of the Xbox. And so for those of you who know about games consoles, here he is, the designer. He is trained as a high-energy physicist. He's also a games designer, and he's now the CEO of venture-backed startup Pacific Light and Hologram. That's Seamus. I'm doing this sort of... Oh, Sasha, fantastic. It's sort of out of order. Sasha is an immersive visualization producer at NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California. She actually joined that team after working in New York in video and web development. But before that, she was head of media and producer at the Field Museum of Natural History in Chicago, which is a... incredible institution, and something that we've all really appreciated. Sitting next to her is an old friend, actually, is Doug Church. I like this, it says, Doug Church is an American. Okay. Good, that's great. No, it says, you know, it actually says, American video game designer. I don't know what that means, but anyway, the fact is, he is one of the pioneers and visionaries of CGI and 3D gaming. He went to work at Looking Glass Studios. He worked in sim games. You probably know him from Ultima Underworld, System Shock, and Thief, and is one of the people who coined the phrase immersive simulation. Last but not least, sitting at the end there, old buddy, a face that we know. Two words he's saying. No, not two words. Scott Ross. Scott Ross partnered with George Lucas in a number of his companies, founded Digital Domain with James Cameron, is now also doing all sorts of amazing work in VR. So, welcome, panel.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Well, thank you, David. We're here to talk about visualizing the impossible, which is a semi-impossible thing to talk about. And what we really mean by this is that all during our lives, we're bombarded. And since the dawn of media, we've been bombarded with visions of the future. People starting in the time of the Sumerians would write about the future, would draw about the future, would create imagery about the future. And that imagery and those ideas that science fiction and futurists presented to us all throughout the centuries have been very influential in the development of technology itself. More often than not, you'll find that people who have developed a technology, when asked about it, will tell you that in their mind was something that they read as a kid or they saw in a television show or on a movie. And so one of the things this group would be outstanding to talk about that I'm going to ask them now is, do we really believe in, and if we do, how powerful is the influence of the imagery that we give to the public about the future in picking out those brains, those minds who are going to invent that future, and focusing them on the things that are most important for us to develop? Like, how much power do we have in that? And I'll throw it to the end because movie guy, go.
Yeah. Well, you know, over the years working on screenplays, it was rare, if ever, where the technology people actually had a direct input on what the vision of the director or the writer was. Almost always, the vision of the director and the writer was before anybody came up with some of the technique. And oftentimes, technology was invented as a result. For example, in The Abyss, with a water weenie creature, with Mary Elizabeth Mastrantonio, that was something that was written by Jim Cameron, and we had no idea how to do it. And so it was the creative that drove the technology.
Do you agree with that, Doug?
Yeah, I think I generally do. And I feel like, you know, Cory on the previous panel mentioned, you know, shooting at the barn and then going and circling the thing you hit. And I think that model is a lot of how this sometimes works, is the creative gives the vision and then investigation happens. And then you go back and say, oh, that's what we were doing all along. Yeah, that's awesome. So I feel like that sort of loop is kind of how it happens often.
When you say that, though, it's a special thing because, you know, one of the things people may not realize about game development is that you're holding both the creative vision and the technology at the same time, and they are having to inform one another. And it can either shackle the creative process or it can sort of unleash it and get you a lot of trouble, like the trouble we were in at Looking Glass together by trying to do things that hadn't been done before and then trying to figure out how to backfill technology into it. And I think, Sasha, this is almost your job description at JPL, right?
I'm sitting quietly and patiently being like, how do I phrase this perfectly? So what I do is quite literally take things to help, I create projects to help scientists and engineers do their jobs. So I create software that's not flight critical for NASA. It's just a tool that will help scientists and engineers do what they do, make their lives a little easier. One example of that is a Mars terrain reconstruction. So we have planetary geologists exploring the surface of Mars through the HoloLens device that Microsoft makes, looking at actual rock formations and doing real science. So the translation of that to the public is quite hard to do unless you have this technology in the palm of your hand. So part of my job is to take that and to do public outreach and to make more web accessible things. So we have a web version of this called Access Mars. But does that tell enough of a story? Is someone gonna look at Access Mars and be like, oh, it's Mars, I'm actually seeing something? But you need the narrative, right? The narrative of scientists using it every day. And I talked to an engineer recently that was formerly working at JPL, and he was like, what's the first most important thing that happens at JPL in any mission formulation? And he worked there like 20 years ago, and I was like, I don't know, which is a great answer that we constantly say at JPL, and I encourage everyone to say that answer if you actually don't know. And he said, the most important part of formulation is the artist concepts that come before a mission is brought to fruition so that people can visualize what they're actually talking about. And that a lot of that comes from actual data. So data that we already have and then projected data that we might have. So I guess my answer is kind of
your whole
on the nose.
Your job is predicated upon the belief, your existence is predicated on the belief that the most powerful thing that we can do to inspire the future we want is to imagine it and distribute that imagination everywhere we can possibly think of.
Yeah, if anything, it's just me screaming at people being like, we have all this stuff and you should use it. And, you know, and also when people see the visualization of Mars for the first time, they just think it's a video game. And we build it in the Unity engine, right? And it is a visualization, so we take data from the Curiosity rover, that the photos that Curiosity takes on Mars, and mix it with orbital data, and then create a pipeline that is dynamic and updates every time there's a downlink from the Curiosity rover. Now, when you explain that part to it, people are like, oh my gosh, that's amazing. Otherwise, they're like, am I just in New Mexico, right? Because it looks like you're standing
Well, I have to say, as a guy from New Mexico who makes video games, both of those are compliments, that it looks like a game that you could be in New Mexico. So I'm all thumbs up. But, you know, it's interesting because you're intentionally doing this. You're intentionally taking scientific progress and wrapping it up in media in order to inspire people to believe in it, to be excited about it, to get funding, which is very important to do. Scott, you were unintentionally doing this. So you're hanging out with Jimbo Cameron, and he's yelling and screaming and nailing shit to the wall. And you're scrambling around to try to figure out how to deal with this vision, and unintentionally, or semi-intentionally at least, compared to Sasha, projecting a vision of the future and a technology of the future, and putting in a very compelling narrative that really has a lot of influence. While you were doing that, did it occur to you that...
Absolutely not. No, without a doubt. I mean, your head is so deep into, I've got a release date, it's on June the 4th, it's this film, it's going to be put out in 5,000 theaters. You're not thinking about where it might go or what it might do. Mm. You're just trying to solve a problem that's in front of you.
Can you think of places in your own work or in other, you know, movies that you love and respect where we've seen the birth of a new technology in media, and we can see it today around us?
Well, computer graphics, for example, as a whole. I go back to the point in time when I was running Industrial Light and Magic, and all the work was done photochemically. There was very little, if any, computer-generated imagery at the time. And when computer-generated imagery first came about with the Pixar Cube, before Pixar, the Pixar Cube, and we started doing things for like Star Trek or movies like that, most of the entire company poo-pooed it and said that it was never going to go anywhere. And so the adaptation of computer-generated imagery really has changed the way feature film and so many other things, video games and beyond entertainment, the way we look at the world.
Well, I think that this segues directly to Doug. I mean, I spent possibly 2 years or more in a small, smelly room with you trying to code up
software development.
Some of the first ever real-time 3D graphics and real-time physics systems. You know, I can remember, I think we were at Logan Airport picking somebody up, and we were drawing tiles on the floor to figure out sorting. And we didn't even really know to call it sorting because it was not a thing you looked up. So, you know, you've been right at the center of the development of that computer graphics technology into interactive, and then that, for instance, in the case of NASA, is now being used as a primary scientific instrument.
Yeah, and even going one further, I mean, to go to, you know, Star Trek type, you know, movie visualization, you know, think about the tricorder. There was a visualization of a lot of things we were going to do with this amazing device. We then ended up building pieces of glass which run our lives. It's not clear if that's good or bad. It's not the same thing, but it's clearly sort of came off that inspiration, and a bunch of people in the space, you know, took that high concept and went with it. And I think you see that in a lot of these sort of mediums where you find some piece of an idea, you focus in on that. I want to represent flying, I want to build a flight simulator, and how do I do that, and what are the pieces, as a random hypothetical.
Random, yes.
And you know, you end up doing probably something very different than what you intended, but sort of along the lines of the original inspiration. So it's not that you need the inspirations because they're the product sheet or the spec. You need the inspiration to start digging into enough detail to start discovering what's actually worth doing.
Right. And so the process of imagining the future and then having to implement it technically,
and realizing that you can't do the thing you imagined.
And the tricorder as an example is a great example, because the people that are building technology that's like the tricorder, especially at JPL, they were watching Star Trek and they didn't even realize that they were wanting to make this thing.
They weren't taking notes.
Until they make the thing, they're like, wait, this is a tricorder.
No, but then when you're presented with a problem, you have in your mind already a map toward where you might want to go with that. You know, and I think if you think of the piece of glass that rules your life. If you have children, you might think of it as the piece of glass that is a babysitter. You know, it's many things to many people, good and bad. But, you know, the cellular technology on which that was built was imagined by people who probably wanted to start a communicator. The satellite systems that had to be in place to handle the data or GPS were built by people who had a different idea. But, you know, I think the power of the imagery that we create for entertainment and storytelling is a power that sets a roadmap in people's minds so that when they sit down technically to work on something, they're not lost. There's a place to follow.
I believe you have to have the context by which to imagine something. And if there's context doesn't exist, it's very difficult to imagine what could be. For example, you know, how many of us really remember what it was like being 6 months old? You know, 9 months old, a year old. Some people say they do, but we didn't have the context of language with which to wrap those ideas around. And we start to understand what life was, you know, where we could describe it as language skills come in. So imagining the future, I think, has to do with the context of imagining what could be from an image or a storytelling or a creative story point of view.
Right, and tying that future into, like, in our exoplanet work that we do at NASA, I mean, our favorite thing, stories to write for the public, are the stories that connect it to something like Star Wars, which is way more tangible for people to understand than talking about planets and stars way outside of our solar system. So it brings it into this kind of science communication realm and really helps
tell
the story. Well,
this begs the larger issue. So, you know, I think that, I mean, it's been fun to talk about, but I think we all fundamentally feel, and probably everybody does, how the ways we imagine the future and talk about it, the stories we tell about the future, influence the direction of our future in a very strong way. So one of the things that's then incumbent upon us, understanding we have this powerful tool, is to tell the right stories that move the human race in the right direction, not towards survival, but toward a future that's meaningful. So what do you guys think some of the directions we should try to push into media might be in that regard?
One of the things we were talking about earlier, and I'd like to sort of bring it up before our time runs out, is the whole concept of machine learning and artificial intelligence and what that might do to designing, developing, and contextualizing what creativity is and therefore what technology might be.
Yeah, for sure.
Anybody ideas on that?
One, I think that idea of, you know, if we're talking about the future, as someone on the previous panel said, you know, when we're here sitting in North America, it's hard to picture a world without capitalism. We're also pretty used to gravity. We're pretty used to a bunch of annoying stuff. You know, that's sort of how it is. If we're envisioning this future, you know, how do we put ourselves in a place where those concept arts or stories are surprises to us as the people who are creating them? And, you know, what are the things we can do to augment our creative capacity or surprise us into other ideas or present us with possibilities we haven't considered so that we can stop iterating? Not, once again, someone else on the previous panel mentioned that we don't want to throw it all out, and I certainly understand that. But how do we push ourselves out of the comfort if we're envisioning a future and start picturing new things?
Well, you do, you know, when we talk about space travel, we talk about the concepts that we're dealing with here at InterPlanetary. One of the things that always occurs to me is the horrifying limited lifespan of human beings. You know, we do throw it all away. We learn all of this, we spend half our lives learning, and then hopefully we make some contributions. How do we ensure those contributions get carried forward, right? And it's difficult to do in a specific way. It's difficult for me to, you know, pass forward, you know, 650 pages of equations that like require, you know, that took me half my life to figure out. So you can pass a spirit, you can pass a set of ideas, you can pass a direction. And that's something that the visual media and storytelling media, you know, are so powerful at.
I think my favorite version of passing along knowledge of our existence is Voyager and the Golden Record. I think that's a pretty good way to do it in a way that makes us still feel like there is something out there showing that we even existed. So I'm glad that happened when Voyager launched, or both Voyagers, as it were. But I wish there was more of that metaphorically happening.
If everything else goes to hell, the gold record, man.
The golden record is out there, and maybe no one will ever find it because there's a lot of space in space, but at least it's out there.
Yeah, there's a terrific essay from January from Stephen Wolfram, which he's helping a friend to make quartz discs like that. And the way he characterizes this project is not as communicating the progress of the human race throughout the galaxy. It's to create a monument in case we vanish, which is such a sad motivation. Basically. Yeah.
Well, yeah. It's good I'm a serial optimist. That's all I have to say. But, I think that the transfer of knowledge is interesting, and making that more of a machine kind of learning thing is complex because that's trying to allow machines to think like us, and can we let go enough? There are all these questions. And, I mean, I'm all about it, mm-hmm. but, you know, as we all know, it has to be done the correct way.
Well, you exist in possibly a freer space than a lot of people making the decisions. You know, I'm going to keep on coming back to this responsibility about direction. You know, when we're making video games, you know, a primary thing on our mind is, you know, super excited about this idea. But also, how am I going to get funded for this? Like, how is this going to work commercially? And it sort of truncates, possibly savagely, the creative space that you can think about in trying to pass positive messages forward. You know, recently, Neal Stephenson, who was speaking earlier, participated in a program with a bunch of writers to talk about positive science fiction for the future, non-dystopian science fiction books. And I believe it's correct that 7Es grew out of this. And I think that in all media, this is a thing that should be on our minds despite all of the constraints that are always on all these processes.
And the things that seemingly sell,
right?
Right, which is generally dystopian stories, more right. so than utopian stories. I mean, I'm a little pitch. So I showed Terminator 2 tonight. It's the ultimate dystopian story, right? Last night was The Fifth Element, sort of a utopian story. But it seems like, you know, the David Finchers of the world continue to want to move that dystopian sensibility out there. And I don't know how we address that, or I think it's our moral responsibility to, but how does
Well, it is, because that story is caught up there with everything else when you go to develop a technology. I think you mentioned machine learning and artificial intelligence. All of those stories are constantly on the minds of the people developing artificial intelligence. I think it's preposterous. I read media stories about, you know, oh my God, why are people developing intelligent machines? Don't they know it's going to kill us? Like, well, yeah, you know, the guys working on these things are not freaking idiots. They've seen Terminator. Like, they understand the danger, and they're thinking about
we
it all the time.
We hope that they've seen Terminator.
Yeah, well, but we hope they, yes. And if they haven't, I'd like to make it a law. But, you know, there's a real responsibility to ensure that that mixture of future roadmaps is rich enough.
Yeah, the tone is harder to pass on than the artifacts. You know, we can build pieces of conceptual work, and we can build, whether it's a piece of art or a piece of glass, and pass that on. But the overall tone is harder to change and goes to a lot of the social engineering stuff mm-hmm. from the previous panel about how and where do we aim that.
Right.
Because that's much harder to, you know, you can't just build that and hand it off.
True.
I think I'm also of the school of humanizing the robotics in a way. So, you know, I have a friend of mine that just graduated from MIT, and she wrote a thesis about her idea was prototyping prototypes, so building robots that build robots. So basically, you can never have to buy a fork again because you can 3D print it. So this practical way of not making waste happen, of connecting to other people, of kind of making things out of really easy parts. So making it a little bit easier and less like I am building a big bad robot kind of situation.
Yeah, I think it's a thought process. You know,
yeah.
You can't. We're not going to decide here, nor is any group of people for any, you know, finite amount of time going to decide what the answer to what this direction should be or how to handle the problem is. But I think it's important to start talking about the fact that it is important to think about, that it needs to factor in and to understand the power of that. You know, when you look back, I'm sure if Gene Roddenberry were with us today, you know, he would be thinking and talking a lot about the legacy of the storytelling and the technology that sort of followed in the wake of Star Trek and how important that was and how lucky it was that he presented such a positive vision. Mm. If the television show that sat in the place of Star Trek had been dystopian, I am sure that the world would be a worse place right now. And that's really something to think about.
And it gets even more powerful in the world of mixed reality and VR, because now we have neuroplastic issues and things are really get much more real and much more difficult in telling those stories.
Yeah, Doug, how do you see the power of storytelling changing as we move into a mixed reality future?
I mean,
small question.
Yeah,
give it 30 seconds.
Actually, yeah,
no big deal.
I do think, you know, there's a degree of sort of presence and immediacy that engages the brain more than it has before. We've taken away a bunch of levels of abstraction. We've taken away a bunch of indirections, and we've replaced them by like, no, you're reaching out and you're shaking that person's hand. You're patting them on the shoulder. That's very different than hitting the A button and having the text, "They smile at you," pop up. You know, there's a degree of brain.
Thank God you don't write video games.
I mean, unless you're into that.
Okay.
Fair.
Right.
Totally fair. But right, there's sort of an immediate lizard brain thing happening as we drive more towards that fidelity and that connection. And so the responsibility goes up. But we have a bunch of creators who maybe are not in that mindset yet. And so where does that all land is a challenge, shall we say.
Well, it sounds like what you're saying is that the peril of that responsibility only increases as our storytelling power increases, right?
Challenge accepted.
Yeah.
I guess, yeah.
All right, so we're almost done, but like in 10 seconds each, like, where would you like to push this? Where do you want to see this go, Scott?
Well, I think we get back to that issue of words are powerful, and that if you envision something, then you have the possibility of having it come true. And if that's a reality, and I believe that it is, I think we have to start to look towards building utopian worlds and building a future that is much more loving. And I think that's critical.
I would say, yeah, you know, more focus on envisioning the systems and the context and the interactions, and less on the pure artifacts, and more on the context for interaction between people and how that goes forward. Because I think it's going to be super important if you go to space, and it frankly would be super important already for all the problems we're having right now. But I'd love to see us focus a little more there, even though it's harder.
For me, I think that you know, the technology's growing. I work in a field where I'm making something kind of specific that I try to communicate with everyone else. But what I stress to everyone always is that I want the audience to become the creators. I want you all to see the content that especially NASA puts out because it's there for you to use. And I encourage so much.
Yes.
I haven't seen it all and will never see it all. It's kind of infinite and ever expanding, sort of like space. And it will always continue. And, you know, I'm an artist that works in science. I want to wave the flag that that is a possibility, especially to young kids that are being asked, which school are you going to choose? I say, you can choose both and kind of carve your own path out of it. And I think that anything is possible in the realm of kind of believing in the content and creating more stuff. So keep making stuff is always kind of my...
Definitely keep making stuff. Thank you guys very much. Thank you to the panel.
Thank you.
What an excellent discussion.